So, welcome to Back to the Future Part 2. Today what we're going to be talking about is the things that you recommended. I'm going to lay out the camera a little bit better for me. The things that you asked, the things that you talked about. And what I want to talk about first, I'm going to combine the CD drive question and the touch bar question and all of it into one answer, into one question. And I think this is what's interesting, and I'm going to take a little bit of time to talk about this. Now, this is the older MacBook Pro. See this guy right here. And it has, I had this discussion with someone last night. It has a power port, it has two USB ports, it has an SD card slot, it has a VGA, it has a an HDMI. It's got all of these different things on it. This is the new MacBook Pro. It has a USB-C port, a USB-C port, a USB-C port, a USB-C port. That's not a joke. And a headphone jack. Now, back in the day, they had Macs that had CD drives. Some of you might still have the Macs that had CD drives. Mm-hmm. Now, I want you to think back to when all computers had CD drives. And think back further than when all computers had floppy disk drives.
Yes.
And I'm not talking about the 3.5, I'm talking about the 5.5-inch floppy disk drives, the giant floppy disk drives.
That's not a giant, 10 inches.
And then before that, they had mice that plugged in with weird ports and things like that. Yeah. Here's the weird thing. A lot of big tech decisions are actually first taken care of by Apple, if that makes sense. So Apple was one of the first companies to stop with the floppy disk. They got rid of the floppy disk. You know, they had the CD drives and they had the floppy disk. Then Apple was one of the first companies to stop with a CD drive. Walk into your local Best Buy right now and try and buy a laptop with a CD drive. You're not going to find it. Now, I ran into almost an argument with someone last night, I'll tell you, over the fact that there's four USB Type-C ports on this machine and nothing else. And this is kind of leading into the touch bar, leading into all these different things. Here's the nice thing about the ports on this machine. The ports on this machine right here, and we're kind of covering almost everything now, but we're going to pull some of the ports on this machine. If you want to plug into an HDMI TV, you have to plug in to this port. The nice thing about the new MacBook Pro is any port can do anything. So I have four ports, but all four of those ports I can plug my charger into. All four of those ports I can plug an HDMI cable into. So if I have an HDMI cable, I put it into this little thing right here. Now, the nice thing is USB-C is what's called an open standard. So I'm getting a game console next week called the Nintendo Switch, and it uses USB-C, and what I like is I'm going to be able to charge my Nintendo product off the same charger I use for my MacBook Pro. And I can charge my phone, the Pixel phone I showed you the other night, off the same charger. And I can charge my projector off the same charger. There is one charger that's going to replace everything.
Oh,
and that's the main thing. Yeah, sweet cheese, but you're not going to like what I'm going to say. Oh, the next iPhone will likely use that charger, which I think is a great thing, because that's the only thing I don't charge with that charger. But some of you are going, but I have a car charger for the phone, and I got a dock for the phone, and I have 47 cables for the new phone, and I have 47 cables for the old big connector sitting around in a drawer at home, right? But too bad you're going to need a new cable. The good news is that'll probably be the last cable you ever need. But what I want you to understand is all of the current Apple computers only have USB Type-C ports. They don't have CD drives. They have USB Type-C. The Pro has four of them. The MacBook, which is the little one right here, has one of them. But what you can do is you can take it, I bought a couple USB Type-C adapters. I can take it like this, and I have power, HDMI, and USB. Or I can take this, and I've got three USB ports and a network jack. Or I can take, I have another one here that I use. Let me find it. It's in the bottom of my bag. Or I can take this, and I have an SD card. But if you were to look at this computer here, if I wanted to transfer something between two SD cards, I would have to take it from the SD card, put it on my desktop, and then move it around. Is that, you know, and put it, this, if I put two SD card adapters in, I have two SD cards. And for a lot of people, they're like, this is annoying. You know, I don't want to have to carry all these dongles and things like that. Here's the thing. All three of these dongles together cost significantly less than any Apple power adapter you can buy. And here's the coolest thing. None of these three things are made by Apple. And they will work across Apple phone. They make their own versions. I'm not saying, but you can use open standards. So you can use open standard charging cables and different things like that with it. But this is where they're all headed. So if you look for a new MacBook, and possibly in the future, if you look for a new desktop, you're just going to have one type of port. But understand, you can turn those ports into anything you want, which is what's very cool. Yeah.
But are there brands that we shouldn't buy?
Okay. Here's the secret I always tell people. Look on Amazon. Make sure the product has at least 100 reviews and has at least 4 stars.
Okay.
That's my feeling. That's how I buy USB-Cs, and I've never had a bad one come up. I mean, I'll tell you, Belkin makes an SD card reader for USB-C that's $99. And someone showed it to me like 3 cruises ago and was so happy I got the Belkin reader that was so hard to get. This is from a company called Aukey, A-U-K-E-Y.
Yeah, see,
this is $4. This is $4.
Wow.
But if you go on Amazon, this reader has about 1,000 reviews on it at 4.75 stars. Out of 5 stars, you've got 4.75 stars. Yeah. What?
Solid.
No, there is a headphone jack. So unlike the iPhone,
it won't go away?
For now, no. The reason it won't go away for now is a lot of people still use Macs for DJing. And when you DJ, you need a headphone jack in order to do that because it splits off the left and the right channel and makes it the different sound. So as of right now, but the honest truth is you can get an external sound card. So you can get a USB-C sound card. Eventually, yes, the sound jack's going to go away. The nice thing about these ports, though, they're waterproof. Now, I'm not saying the Mac is waterproof. Don't spill water on your new Mac and come back and blame Richard. But they're waterproof. They can be waterproofed, if that makes sense. But one of the other major changes that happened, and I'm going to see if I can show this to you properly. One of the other major changes that happened with the new MacBook Pros is something called the Touch Bar. Now, I'm going to put this up on the screen because it's really hard for everyone to see it. Instead of all of the keys that used to be on the MacBook Pro, there's now a little screen that lives on your MacBook Pro. And to get in, you see that little black thing right there?
Yeah.
That's actually a fingerprint sensor. So that's a Touch ID sensor. So I can go in and I can go with my fingerprints. So instead of typing a password in all the time, and going back to your multiple user question, we're going to get back to it in a little more detail, but talking about your multiple user question, someone can just pick up the computer, if they're a registered user, touch their thumbprint, and it'll automatically log into their user account. Because Macs are designed to be multi-user. iPhones and iPads are designed to be single user. But I'm going to show you something real quick. So if I go in, there's actually a setting for Touch ID. That's sideways. It's actually a setting for Touch ID. Let me show it to you on the screen real quick. And I can add in multiple fingers and multiple things into Touch ID. And I'll show you how this works. It works very similar to your iPhone or your iPad. So for every user, I can add up to 5 fingers, and I can identify up to 5 users. So I have essentially 25 fingerprints I can put in. And if I just go ahead, I'll show you how this works. I hit Add Fingerprint. I need to put in my password. And then place and rest your finger. This is a finger that I use sometimes, and I've never programmed this in. And it's very similar to how you'd use it on an iPhone or an iPad.
Hmm.
Now, what's happening a lot with Macs nowadays is what we call the iOSification of the Mac. It's becoming more like an iPhone or an iPad, and the iPhone and iPads are becoming a lot more like the Mac. Now, your question was, what can Touch ID do on a Mac? So it can lock and unlock your Mac. And the only ones it's in right now is the new Pros. They're called the Touch Bar Pros. But it can lock and unlock your Mac. It can also do iTunes and App Store purchases. But my absolute favorite thing it can do is Apple Pay. So I can go in and I can actually do Apple Pay. I'll pull this
so
up for
you. Do you recommend Apple Pay? I heard you.
I recommend Apple Pay highly, 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 highly. I don't know if we're going to get directly to talk about Apple Pay during this trip, but I want to show you an Apple Pay transaction. I've shown some of you this already. But I think this is really, really cool. I bought something on Apple Pay. This was when I first got my MacBook Pro. I'm sitting in bed, and it comes across. There's an option that says Pay with Apple Pay. Oh. And all I did was put my finger on the fingerprint sensor.
Oh, wow.
It says processing. It'll say done in a few seconds. It's a video. I want to speed up a video. But done. It goes done. And you'll see that the charge went through on my credit card. right there. So you can use the Touch ID for the same thing on your Mac. But here's also another great thing. Every time your Mac asks you to type in a password, you know, when you want to change something or we're talking about password, you can use your fingerprint instead. So you don't have to remember the password. So every time you want to change something, you want to do something, you can actually type in your, you put in your fingerprint instead of your password, which is
can
what's
you
very
do that
cool.
On iPhone?
Yeah, you can do Touch ID on your iPhone. Yeah.
No,
same.
No, but can you
Apple Pay?
No, instead of like remembering all your passwords.
We're going to get into that today, actually, in the iCloud class, to give you an idea. I'm going to show you something called iCloud Keychain in the iCloud class today. So we will get there, but I don't want to get there right now. Oh, we'll get there later.
Yeah, Keychain.
We'll talk about Keychain later. It's okay. So that's an idea. And the Touch Bar gets a little bit more advanced, depending on the programs you use it with. So depending on how you use the Touch Bar, let me show you in Mail real quick. When I open up the Mail application, I have all of these options. If I want to write a new message, instead of taking the mouse and going up and hitting new message, I can actually just hit this little button right here, and then I get a new message. It puts shortcuts directly to all of your things right on the touch screen there. They just updated Microsoft Office. It's not something I use, but they just updated Microsoft Office for the Touch Bar. And I can go in and I can do Excel formulas and different things like that. On Word, it's got something called concentration mode, where what it does is it removes all of the top bar and everything and gives you all of your controls just on your touch bar. So you don't see anything there. It is a developing technology. I mean, what you need to realize is back in the day when they introduced the fingerprint sensor on the iPhone 5S for the first time, all that fingerprint sensor would do was lock and unlock the phone. That's all it did back in the day. Now it does a lot more. You can lock apps, you can secure apps, you can do all of that. I'm showing you the baseline of what the Touch Bar does, and I would be remiss if I didn't show you my favorite thing the Touch Bar does. A friend of mine wrote this program because the Touch Bar really didn't have a purpose when it came out. Absolutely no purpose. I gotta stop it. No! There we go. But here's the cool thing to understand. This is an evolving technology, and essentially what it is they took the MacBook Pro and they built an Apple Watch into the top of it. So it's running the same processor, the same chip as the Apple Watch. So they've actually built an Apple Watch into the top of your MacBook Pro. Now, how many of you have a Windows computer with a touchscreen? I have a Windows computer with a touchscreen. The problem is, everybody always asks me, they go, when are they going to put a touchscreen on a Mac? And I would say, this is the closest you'll probably see to a touchscreen on a Mac for quite a while, because here's the problem. If you want to touch your Mac, you have to get off of the keyboard and touch the screen, and people don't do that. So what they did is they put a touchscreen right on the keyboard. So they put the touchscreen right there on the keyboard. So the interesting thing, and we're not going to go in linear order. The interesting thing that makes these Macs and all these different things different is called a solid state drive. Yeah, your question back.
Yeah, what's the advantages for people that are used to shortcuts and using that versus the shortcuts?
So you can actually, so here's the cool thing. A lot of apps will put shortcut menus up there. If you know the shortcuts, you're okay, but certain apps allow you to remap the shortcuts. So you can add additional shortcuts, you can add different actions and things like that. So I have a lot of stuff that I've worked on for the Touch Bar. I'll tell you a lot of the stuff that I've dealt with the Touch Bar. I'm still under what's called a non-disclosure agreement on, because it hasn't been released to the general public yet, if that makes sense. So the tech exists. I would love to show you some really, really awesome stuff that I can't show you because of non-disclosure agreements, but there's companies like 1Password that will have a Touch Bar thing and it'll show you your accounts right across the top. Essentially what this is it's the merging together of the iPhone and the iPad and the Mac and everything together. And what I think is really funny, do you see the size of the trackpad on this thing? It is bigger than the iPhone 7 Plus. But it gives you a huge surface, and nobody makes trackpads that are better than Apple's trackpads. Now, one of the things that changed on the new MacBook Pro was touch bars, but if any of you still have either an iMac or a Mac that has a CD drive, you might say, oh, this Mac is slowing down a bit. And the old answer that Vince brought up a few minutes ago is add more RAM, add more RAM, add more RAM. And you have no idea, every time I get on the ship, I will tell you one of the nice things is, working on Celebrity, almost every single one of our senior officers uses a Mac. Puts me in a very good position to have a very easy life on the ship. But what happens is, I have all these senior officers all the time that come to me and they go, I have a 3-year-old Mac, and it's getting slow. Do I need a new Mac? And the answer is actually generally no. Macs are designed to last for about 5 years or so. But there was a big change in the Macs about 3.5 years ago or so, in which they moved from moving hard drives to solid state disk, or SSDs. So I actually teased, I gave you a little preview of what an SSD was the other day. I've got, this is just a normal hard drive. And this one I showed in the Google Photos class the other day is an SSD. So this is a solid state hard drive. Here's the difference. There's nothing in this, so I can do this, okay? Let me double check. Okay, so it's an empty case. So this is a hard drive holder. But I can very say, if I had this hard drive, and I had a hard drive in here, and I went like that, that hard drive would work no more. Because it has a moving part, it has a moving head that goes around inside, and as soon as it hits, the head scratches the disk, and that messes up. This is an SSD. Very expensive, I just got it the other day, but it's fine. I could drop it in a puddle of water, it'd be fine. I could drop it in a puddle of mud, it would be fine. The idea is a solid state disk is solid state storage. It's the same thing that's in an iPhone or an iPad or an SD card. But here's the thing the F word. He said, or a flash drive. Here's the thing to understand. Flash drives generally, unless they're hundreds of dollars of flash drives, use very low end SSDs inside of them. Very, very low end SSDs. This is a very high-end SSD, and it is from Samsung, so as I say, whenever we bring out something Samsung, fire extinguishers are right outside that door and right outside that door. But what's very cool is this SSD uses USB Type-C. So what I use is I have big hard drives down in my cabin to store a lot of files and stuff like that, but when I need to plug something in, I do it that way. The older machines, no matter how much RAM you add to an old Mac, an iMac or anything like that, it is not going to make it nearly as fast as putting in an SSD. Here's the problem I'm going to tell you, though. Nobody's going to do it for you. If you bring it to the Apple store, they're not going to put it in. They're going to sell you a new Mac. That's the trouble. You have to find a nerd that'll do it. I do every week, I do 2 SSD installs for people on the ship. I just order them off Amazon. I order a 512 gig SSD. It costs me about $150. But the problem is you have to migrate the stuff over from the old hard drive to the SSD, and it's a bit of a pain. But why your machine is slowing down is because the operating system, El Capitan, is built for machines that have SSDs. It has legacy support for the older machines that have spinning hard drives. Now, on the desktop for the last 3 years or so, they've used something called a fusion drive, which is a normal hard drive paired up with an SSD. So it speeds it up a bit. But where your limiting factor is if you have a Mac that still has a CD drive, it is very likely that that Mac still has a moving hard drive inside. Moving hard drives get slow, they die, they get full of junk. SSDs don't. But here's the thing I need you to understand, though. This moving hard drive, what's normally in this moving hard drive is 2 terabytes of storage. What's in this SSD is one quarter of the amount of storage. It's 500 gigs of storage, so half a terabyte of storage. SSD is significantly faster, but significantly more expensive on a per gigabyte basis. So back in the day, if you were to buy a MacBook Pro, it might have come, your one you bought back in the day, with a 750 gigabyte hard drive. Correct. It probably came with 750 gigabyte, maybe 500 gigabyte, maybe even a terabyte hard drive inside of it. Here's the problem. The new MacBook Pros come standard with a 256 gigabyte hard drive. So they come with a quarter of the space. So if you're going to buy a new MacBook Pro, I want you to understand that you're going to use that new MacBook Pro in tandem with an external hard drive. Don't go out and spend $2,000 more than the Mac to get a Mac with a 2 terabyte SSD inside, because you don't need it. When you need a project, you keep it on your Mac. So for an example, I'm going to show you something that's going to go back to your question here. For an example, I have on my Mac a folder called EC218. And EC218 is the cruise we're currently on. We're on EC Cruise 218. And I have all of the classes in this folder for EC218. Now I'm taking these classes in full HD. So these classes total, I can tell you how big the folder is, just for fun. This is why I can't airdrop it to anybody, are 53 gigs so far. Just the classes from this cruise are 53 gigs. So I've got those classes right there. I only have a 256 gig hard drive on my computer. So what I do is at the end of the cruise, I would take this file right here and I would copy it off of my computer onto a flash drive. Now, what a flash drive is it is a low-end SSD. So I want you to imagine like this. If you go to McDonald's, you can get a cheeseburger. If you go to Ruth Chris, I don't know, you know who Ruth Chris is.
Oh, yeah.
You can technically get a hamburger at Ruth Chris. It's a nice hamburger.
Yeah,
I've had it before
nice
at Ruth Chris. The difference between a flash drive and a high-end SSD is a McDonald's hamburger versus a Ruth Chris hamburger. They're both hamburgers. One of them shouldn't be called a hamburger. There's a reason that they give out flash drives with companies' logos on it and stuff like that. Those things cost 30 cents each. This is a $170 500 gig flash drive, and all I have to do to copy this off is I plug it in, and conveniently, it's got USB Type-C on the end. And what you're going to see is more and more products are going to come out with this plug on it instead of the big USB plug.
But if we only have a regular SD
on
our computer, that's useful.
No, not at all. Because here's the cool thing. In the box comes two cables.
Oh.
One that has USB-C and a normal USB end, and one that has USB-C and a USB-C end. So you can always invert it. It's going towards the future. So right now, when you have your old MacBook Pro, you can use the USB-C to USB-A, which is what the full-size one is. And when you get a new MacBook Pro, use the USB-C to USB-C. So I would plug this guy in, and since it's solid state, it's going to come up nearly instantly, just because I want it to. And you'll see this is called the Samsung T3 drive. Now I have, right here, I have 53 gigs of files. If you were to copy 53 gigs of files to a flash drive, you would drag it. It would probably tell you there's not enough space on the flash drive. You'd go for lunch, you'd go for dinner, you'd come back, it wouldn't be done. I'm just going to show you so you can see how quick this is. Hopefully it doesn't shame me. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to copy 53 gigs, and it's going to take like 20 minutes to copy 53 gigs. I'm not going to really, actually I'm going to copy it now. So I have an extra backup copy up. But I got 25 minutes to actually copy 53 gigs, which is a huge amount of data. So understand the difference between hard drive and flash drive is this is very fast, and I want you to understand something else. Technically, if I were to plug this into my computer, this is just as fast as the storage that's actually on my computer, to give you a little concept there. So these are called, if you have a new MacBook Pro or an old MacBook Pro, these are called Samsung T3 drives. I love, love, love them, and they've come down in price a lot.
Yeah.
You can buy a 250 gig one for about
100 bucks.
100 bucks, yeah. You're on Amazon now? Or I bought the 500 gig for 150, I think it made 170. Yeah, I bought it. Well, I used Camel,
yes,
and I bought it at 150 last week. But I can go in, and this is a hard drive that's waterproof, drop-proof, shock-proof, everything-proof. Yes?
I'm trying to get my head around this, because previously I'd always stored everything on my computer.
Yes.
And then I started buying external hard drives because I wanted to keep my photographs,
uh-huh,
and music,
uh-huh,
and things on it. But do you have a collection of these?
Do I have a collection of these? So I'll answer your question, because this is a very interesting question. So anything that's on your computer, as we learned in the class the other day, if it's on your computer, is it a backup?
No.
It's a copy.
It's a copy.
Remember from Google Photos. So what I have is I have two of these. I had a 250 gig one. I just bought a 500 gig one because I felt like upgrading. There's nothing wrong with my 250. I just wanted a bigger one. But these are my throw-around drives. I bring these with me all over. In my cabin, I have something very interesting, and there's only one other person in this room that has it. I have two of them. They're called Synologies. And what they are, they're very hard to describe, but they're these big, ugly boxes that are filled with hard drives, and they're linked up to my network. And what we're going to eventually have, this is kind of going into an interesting place of where we're going to go at 1 o'clock, we're going to eventually be able to roll our own cloud in our house, which is essentially what I do. I live in a cloud, but the cloud isn't on the internet. The cloud is in my cabin. If that makes sense. So I have a big hard drive in my cabin that has everything on it. And so I'm copying this 218 to my Voyage 218, I'm copying to this drive right now. When I get back to my cabin, I'm gonna plug it into my iMac that I have in my cabin, and then I'm gonna transfer it to my storage drives that I have. And it's kind of like putting something in deep freeze. So the thing is, let me go where you're going, because you have your big hard drives that you back up all your pictures to. Those stay at home. If you get something like a high-end flash drive, they do make Ruth Chris flash drives. They're not from Ruth Chris, but if you get something like a high-end flash drive that's quick, you can use that, you can bring that around, or you can get something like this. This is essentially a high-end flash drive. The nice thing about this is this will work with computers. It'll also work with a lot of phones. No, not the iPhone. But it'll work with a lot of phones. It might work with the iPhone. I'm going to show you an iPhone hard drive in the iCloud class later today, in the cloud class at 1 o'clock today. I'm going to show you one that works with the iPhone. But here's what if you understand nothing other than this, this is the way that storage is going, and you're still going to have moving storage for storing large quantities of data, but that moving storage will stay in one place. Yeah.
The question, my real concern about this is my external hard drives, G drives, ones Apple stores, have corrupted all the time, and I've had real problems with external hard drives, so it makes me very concerned about storing information.
Here's the answer. Again, the newer operating systems are designed for solid-state drives, and they don't corrupt nearly as much anymore. I've never had a solid-state drive corrupt on me. Have I had the other drives corrupt on me? I'll be honest with you. That is why we always keep backups of backups of backups of backups of backups. But the main thing, let me ask you a loaded question. The main thing you backed up on the hard drives was pictures, right?
Pictures and iTunes.
Okay, iTunes. Another story for another day, but the main thing you backed up was pictures, correct? Do we know how to back up pictures properly now?
Google.
You missed that class. That makes two of you. I did it twice. So they backed them up in about three different places, Google Photos, every place you have your drive. Now, touch bar and what you can do, difference in specs and more details, when to unplug. Is a loaded question that Vince asked, and I'm going to tell you something that happened right over here. So do you see that fire sprinkler right there?
Yeah.
3 years ago, that fire sprinkler burst. Because I'm going to tell you an honest thing that I don't like telling people, but it's the truth. When we did, if you've been on this ship a couple years ago, you remember we used to have Mac laptops in this room. We had 15-inch MacBook Pros, and we kept them plugged in for 3 years straight. And one of the batteries burst. Wasn't too bad. Fire sprinkler put it out right away, but that's why we stripped out all the Macs and we put iMacs in here, because the batteries kept expanding and kept smoking and kept setting. It was just not a good idea. And it was because what we did is we left the machines plugged in 24/7, 365 days a year. The machines were unplugged for about 10 minutes every 3 months. And what that 10 minutes was is when they do the blackout test. When we're in the busiest port, like next cruise when we're in St. Martin, they're going to turn off all the electricity on the ship for 10 minutes just to make sure all the backup stuff works. Like some of these lights, if any of you see a light above you with a red dot on it, see these lights? There should be one with a red dot. Which one?
This one.
It's that one. So in the event that all the power goes out, that light will still stay on. So that light's on a battery backup, just to give you an idea. So they do tests to make sure that all works, but we kept it plugged in for 3 years straight. The batteries expanded. I'm going to tell you who the batteries in the old MacBook Pros were made by. I bet you can already guess.
Samsung.
How'd you know? They were made by Samsung. But the thing is, you can use a Mac, can leave it plugged in, can use it as a desktop, but every month or so, just unplug it and use it as a laptop for a little bit. I don't even say you have to move it around. Just unplug it every month or so and use it as a laptop. Yeah. You can leave the battery charging all the time. The problem is when the battery continually sits at 100%, sometimes the battery can expand. The physical battery can expand. So you want to watch out for that. So you can charge it all the time, just every month or so. Just drain it down 5% and you're okay. It's just because it needs to know where the top is, if that makes sense. That makes sense there. Okay.
MacBook or iMac? You said you could use MacBook. A MacBook instead of an iMac?
Yeah,
iMac.
No, so I use a Mac Mini, but that's a little confusing to say. I use a Mac Mini. I don't use an iMac. I used to use an iMac, but I use a Mac Mini. My mom uses an iMac because it's an all-in-one and it's very simple to use, but I use a Mac Mini to give you a little idea there. What my logic was, and this is what Vince keeps referencing because this is something I said, I don't think it's worth most people going out and purchasing an iMac nowadays.
Oh, really?
Because, what I mean by iMac, the desktop, because you can buy a MacBook Pro and buy a monitor at Costco and plug that monitor into your MacBook Pro, and guess what you have?
An iMac.
You have a desktop. And then you still have a laptop when you need it, so you can take your desktop on the go with you. The main reason the desktop still exists, and this is something we go back to the talk we did at the tea time, is that businesses still want desktops that nobody can drag home and steal and stuff like that.
That's why you have them here.
These desktops all came with wireless keyboards and mice.
Oh.
You notice?
Oh.
Yes, after four of them disappeared, we got wired ones. Oh. Tell you another thing. I replaced four mouse pads a cruise because people think that those mouse pads
souvenirs.
Are souvenirs of their celebrity cruise vacation, to give you a little idea there. Yeah.
Do they take the towels too?
The towels? Well, that's why all of my towels at home say celebrity cruises on. No. Got some great yellow beach towels. No, I'm kidding. Yeah. Okay. I don't know what he was. Okay. So I want to move on. I want to go to the next thing. Security preferences. Someone asked about what type of security to use. Yeah. He had a question, or he's just raising his finger. Okay. We're just doing a sight test over there. I couldn't see. So security preferences. Which leads into passwords, which leads into different things like that. When you secure your Mac, there are no rules to the password, which is the nice thing. I'm going to tell you what Ron's password is. Ron's password for his Mac, not that you can do much with it, but Ron's password for his Mac that he has, the one that's there, is that little thing next to the Enter key and then the Enter key. This is a quick way for us to get into it. We just go, boop, boop, and then we're in, but you wouldn't even know what you were doing with it. You don't have any rules to your password on a Mac, but you want to make sure you have something at least relatively strong. And when you talk with security preferences, I'm still copying that there. I got about 16 minutes left on copying that. When I talk about security preferences, there's something on a Mac that I want you to be very aware of that will come up if you get a new Mac or if you upgrade your Mac. There's something that's going to come pre-checked on your Mac, and I want to make sure you all uncheck it, because it's very important that we uncheck it, and you're going to go, huh? Why is that? Who's that? Some of you probably have it checked already. It's called File Vault.
Called what?
Really? File Vault.
File Vault.
File Vault. Now. It's going to ask you this when you set up your Mac. It's going to ask you that if you already have it. You go into System Preferences, Security and Privacy, and there's something called File Vault. What that is full disk encryption. Great idea, great theory, everything like that. But guess what happens if you forget any of your passwords on your Mac ever? There is a thing called SOLTF. She said it! She didn't say the end. Yeah, you're SOLTF. So if you have, who forgot their password? You forgot your password in the pink, right?
I forgot my password, and it keeps saying
and here's the problem.
Wants to know what
right.
It is.
If you have File Vault on, if you upgraded your operating system, you turn it on, I'm giving you the concept, is it's going to give you nothing but painfulness about that. When I have crew members that have File Vault on and their disk has gotten corrupted or different things like that, I cannot remote in and see the disk. I can't plug in. I can't do anything. It is military-grade encryption, but let's be honest. Does anybody in this room really need that?
No.
It's something that's turned on by default, and what it does is it makes your machine slower.
Somebody else can play my games?
when you upgrade your operating system, it's going to say, do you want to turn on File Vault? And it'll be automatically checked, and it'll say, File Vault, yes, File Vault, yes. And what happens is it slows down your computer. So what you might have that on. When you turn off, I can look on your machine later. When you turn off File Vault, though, you need to be plugged in for about 24 hours because it's going to decrypt your whole drive. So it's encrypted on the drive. It's a bit painful, but it's called File Vault, and it's an encryption. Now, another thing, how many of you, when you start your computer, it automatically logs in with your computer? If it automatically logs in. One of the nice things is, you see how this is asking me for a login screen? Huh? My keyboard thing's falling out. Asking me for a login screen here. One of the nice things is if I have my Apple Watch on, it will actually unlock my Macs for me automatically. One of the coolest features when you talk about security. So if you open up your Mac, if you're wearing your Apple Watch, it'll go bing, and then your watch will say that your Mac was unlocked with your Apple Watch. But that's another thing entirely when we're talking about security. I'm getting into my machine.
Encryption
I can't do three questions at a time. Her first.
Because Apple's becoming, before it was difficult to hack into Apple, but apparently now it's becoming more easy.
Apple is very difficult to hack into, nearly impossible to hack into. Here's the simple answer, okay? Hacking nowadays, the reason that hacking happens, and I'm going to reiterate this 100,000 times, the major three reasons that hacking still happens nowadays, I'm going to list them, and you're going to go, oh. AOL, Yahoo, and Hotmail are the three major reasons people are still hacked nowadays. It came out that Mike Pence, our vice president, had his AOL account hacked and had sensitive government information taken out of his AOL account. If you haven't had your Yahoo account hacked, then that's impossible because everybody's Yahoo account's been hacked. The security problems are no longer in the specific devices because as long as nobody gets, if somebody steals your machine, they need a password to do anything to it. The major security holes come over emails. That's why I want to make sure that everybody's using Gmail. It's not a selfish thing. It's AOL, their last security people that worked at AOL were fired 7 years ago. They've had nobody working security at AOL for 7 years. Think about that for a second. Yahoo fired their last people about 5 years ago. Hotmail's only hired people for their paid Hotmail service. So,
I've had an AOL
account. I understand that you've had an AOL account for years. Yeah, I know, so have I. I've had it probably before you did.
So can you just get rid of that? How do you, like...
That's tomorrow. That's a discussion for tomorrow. We're going to talk about that. We've got a whole class on Gmail tomorrow. I just want to let you know, the problem with the security is not that. There's one more big ugly animal in the room. That's the reason that most viruses and most hacking happens still. And it's called Internet Explorer. Any of you use Internet Explorer?
Yeah.
Microsoft Edge?
Yeah.
Internet Explorer serves one purpose. The first time on your Windows computer, you open it up, you download Google Chrome, and then you delete Internet Explorer.
Oh.
It's the entire purpose of Internet Explorer is to download Google Chrome. Bad people, here's the thing I'll always tell you, bad people always try and get in through the most used thing. Does that make sense there? They always try and get in through the most used thing. Macs are less than 10% of the market. So they're not going to focus on Macs. They're going to focus on Windows computers with Internet Explorer and AOL accounts and Yahoo accounts and Hotmail accounts. That's the honest truth. So as weird as it sounds, the most beneficial thing you can do to protect yourself with security is to not have an account with a bad...
Download Google Chrome,
yeah.
And then delete...
You're better than Safari.
Safari.
Personally, well, we'll get into that a little bit.
Delete
Internet Explorer. Don't go hitting on Safari just yet. Delete Internet Explorer. Now, Mac apps. Let's talk about Mac apps, because that's on here. Sharing a Mac. Okay, when is too old? We talked about that. CD drive, flash drive. Something I did without showing you. All I did, let me show her something that I did real quick that I didn't realize I wasn't showing. I showed it, but I didn't show it. I did it, but I didn't point out that I was doing it. She said, how do you put something on a flash drive? Mm-hmm. And then we're going to talk about Mac apps. I already went ahead and I did this because I plugged in my little solid state drive and all I had to do, hey, come on up. All I had to do was take the file from my desktop or wherever it is and drag it into the flash drive. So you see, there's the flash drive called Samsung whatever, whatever, whatever. And I can just take a file, DCIMCF, and drop it right on there. And then it copies it in. I do it so second nature that I don't even recognize that I'm doing it. Yeah.
But I want to put it into another file on that flash drive, let's say.
Yeah. So that's to put it in the main thing. If I wanted to put it in another file, I can just make a new folder and I can say new. And there's new. Click on new. Let me bring something small.
Should I be paying extra for Apple Store?
That's a discussion for later today. We will get there. The quick answer is no. There's no reason to pay for iCloud storage. You don't need it. Because the majority of stuff you're keeping in your iCloud storage are photos and videos. And I'm sure most of us in this room already know the answer to where we put the photos and videos. Google Photos. I'm going to show you how to downgrade the storage at the 1 o'clock class today. I'm going to take questions in a minute, but I want to show you a couple Mac apps, because someone asked for a couple Mac apps. Now, these are apps that you get after the fact. These are not apps that come with the Mac. And what I have is I have my personal Mac I'm going to plug in right now. I'm going to show you some apps that you get after the fact, some of the most useful apps you can get. Let me unplug this real quick, because I didn't realize what was here.
Are there ones specific to Mac?
Some of them are. I'm going to show you some stuff. I'm going to show you the best video player right now that you can get on any device. Let me see what the heck. That's all my illegal stuff. I don't show that. Okay. There we go. So one of the first ones I want to talk about is what I call the parking cone application. This is available for Windows, Mac, iPhone, iPad. We're going to revisit this in the VIP class tomorrow at 3:30. It's called VLC. One of the most useful pieces of software you can have. It looks like a parking cone. I'm not going to really open it right now. I'm going to try and find it. Here we go. It's called VLC. Right here. It will play any video file on any device.
What would you do
with,
what's a video file?
Any video file. So, if someone has someone ever sent you a video, an email, an attachment or something, and you've tried to play it on your Mac and it's just said, no thank you.
Yes, right.
This program will play it. Okay. This will play anything. That's what's really cool. It's called VLC. It is completely free and it will play anything. Now, there are some Mac apps that are really cool and there are some Mac apps that are really dumb. Let's start with the Mac app that's really dumb, but I love it. It's called... It's called Tie Sight, and it teaches you how to tie a tie.
Oh, gosh, that's funny.
So, I have no clue how to tie a tie.
Oh, how funny. You put your face there. Oh, my God.
So, you put your face there.
That is funny.
I need to send that to my
that
side.
That is so cool.
And then you can actually go in and you can say, next. Turn around. Yeah. I don't actually... Next. It's called Tie Sight. It's a great app. I love it. Now this is my personal Mac, so it's got some unique things on it right now. Now this one's actually really cool. Now a lot of these apps I'm going to show you now are apps you can get from the Mac App Store. This one is called Space Gremlin. Space Gremlin. Gremlin, like the little green things from the movies.
Okay.
And what Space Gremlin does is it tells you where all the space on your computer has gone. So you open it up, you can run this on your computer, or you can run it on a hard drive. You'll see I have, out of 512 gigs, I have 97 gigs free. We're going to come back to this in a minute because it's scanning my computer right now, but what it's going to give me, it's going to give me a visual representation of my entire hard drive.
Do you need to know that?
Do you need to know that? Here's the thing to be very interesting with. In the new Macs, if you have a Mac laptop, mm-hmm. you have a very limited amount of storage space on your Mac laptop. Mm-hmm. So you might say, what's taking up my storage space? And it's very hard to find if there's a gremlin hidden somewhere. And that's why they call it space gremlin. Is it actually, so I'm going to come back to this in a minute. It's actually scanning my computer right now. But yeah, it's called Space Gremlin. But here's another one called Gemini. Like the astrological sign.
Is that yours?
What? That is my astrological sign. Me too. And I didn't believe in, I'm going to tell you, I didn't believe in any of this astrological stuff, to be honest with you. I still don't really believe it. But someone was sitting in my class about 3 years ago, and she goes, I'm going to read your star signs. And she gave me one of the most accurate things I've ever seen, and it's so funny. Because it was dead on. It was dead on. I don't know how, now I know it's all a trick. Be honest, if you really believe in that stuff, it's all a trick. But she was able to predict things that I would have never
something
said.
Nothing went wrong.
No, nothing went wrong. Maybe something went wrong.
She hacked your computer.
Yeah. She works for Yahoo.
Does she work for Yahoo? Okay, so this is a very simple one. Let me give you an example. I'm going to take a file, and I'm going to put the same file. I'm going to put the same file in a folder twice. So you see that same file is in the folder twice?
Yes.
I will then take this folder, drag it on top of Gemini, it will scan it and find the duplicate files.
So this can delete.
So it said it found it, and I can say show results. Now here's the cool thing. You can do this with your iTunes library, with your Photos library, and it will automatically remove the duplicate files. What's really nice about this program is when it deletes the file, it will actually put a shortcut to the other file. So if you have it in one place and not in the other, you'll always be able to link it there. Now, just for fun, because Gemini's done, let me show you my Gemini. That's a visual representation of what's taking up all of my storage space, which is what's really cool. So it's a visual representation of what's taking up all my storage space. So let me find another app to show you. What we got? I got a lot of apps. Okay, this one's very cool. It's called Boom. B-O-O-M. I'm not going to show this to you on the screen because it's not going to make sense to show it on the screen. I have to find something. I have to find some music. Good question if I have any music. MP3. Oh, God. What is this junk? I have a lot of music that's pretty bad. Okay, this is reasonable. Enrique Iglesias by Landau. Let me get this. I have to turn it off. Okay. So. That's as loud as my Mac goes. Good? Okay. So I got music going here. That's as loud as my Mac normally goes. If I turn on Boom. You hear the difference there? Here's the thing I want to be honest with here, though. This is built into the Mac App Store, so you're not going to blow out your speakers. It's not going to invalidate your warranty or anything, but it makes your speakers 2 times louder on your Mac laptop. It's called Boom. Now, if I showed it on the screen, it would obviously show the stuff. It would play the sound from the screen, but here is before and after, so you can see. So that's no Boom. It's actually an amplifier for your Mac, which is really...
It's only for the Mac, not for the iPad or iPhone?
They technically make it, so the app, that's actually a good question, the app will do something for the iPad or iPhone, but doesn't work natively on the iPad or iPhone. There's a lot, a Mac app will do a lot of things that iPhone and iPad apps can't do, but what's cool is in this app, you can drag a song into the app, and it will boost the volume on the song, and then you can sync it back to your iPhone or your iPad. So it doesn't work.
Yeah.
It doesn't work with everything on your iPhone or iPad, but if you pre-do your songs, then yes, it will pre-do your songs. So that one's called Boom. This one is great. I love this application. My friend over here could have used this application yesterday. Love this one. I usually do this before I teach a class. It's called Desktop Pirate. Best Mac app I've ever had. What it does is you open it up and it says two things, R, hide me treasures, matey, or fetch me treasures or walk the plank. And when I hit R, hide me treasures lately, you see all this crap that's on my desktop?
Yeah.
Go away. Go away. Boop.
Wow.
I have a clean desktop. And it's very important.
Temporary?
What?
It's temporary?
Yeah, then I just hit fetch me treasures or walk the plank. And they'll come back.
Why would you
take them off? So what would you?
If you're doing a presentation like me and you don't want to look like an animal and have things all over your desktop.
What's it called?
It's called Desktop Pirate.
Desktop Pirate.
What does walk?
You really need a life.
I got two. I got something for you. Now I want you to write these two down. I'm not going to explain what they do right now because I don't have a way to explain them. Because how many of you? I'll explain why. How many of you still have iPods that might have music on them or older iPhones that might have music on them? Now, this is going to blow some people's minds, and I start saying this later today. A lot of people don't realize iTunes is not owned by Apple. iTunes is owned by the music and movie industry. And one of the things the music and movie industry don't want you to do is to be able to plug an iPhone with music into your computer and then suck off the music into the computer. Because then I can give Vince my phone and Vince can take all of my music. And then you can give Vince your phone and Vince can take all your music. But a lot of people want to take, maybe they have an old Windows, you know, they have an iPod that was plugged into a Windows computer, that Windows computer is now dead. There's two programs to get stuff off of your old device. One's called Detune and one's called XPod. They both do the same thing. I don't have a preference. They kind of live right next to each other, Detune and XPod.
Is that spelled
D-E-T-U-N-E and E-X-P-O-D. Deletion. Let's talk about deletion for a minute. Have any of you ever tried to delete an app? on a Mac. You know how to uninstall an app on your Mac. You probably have no clue how to uninstall an app on your Mac. Well, so, good question.
But it's still there.
She said something very interesting. She said the little X. If it was easy as getting rid of the X is that, we would all get rid of our X's. Sometimes when you jiggle apps, the apps will have the little X's.
Yeah.
But those are only apps that come from the Mac App Store. What's different on the Mac compared to the iPhone or iPad is you can install apps from other places other than the App Store. So understand, we can install apps from other places other than the App Store. So if it doesn't have a little X, like XPod or Detune, do you know how to delete it? No. Just throw it to the trash? Bad idea. Still though, even going to applications won't do it. I want to show you an app. Now, I'm gonna reference back to my friend because she brought her Mac in the other day. She had two terrible pieces of software on her Mac. Let's be honest. She had the worst piece of software you can put on your Mac that I guarantee at least half of you in this room have on your Mac. It's a program called Mac Keeper.
Oh,
it is a piece of trash. It is a piece of trash. It slows down your machine to no end, and one of the most difficult pieces of software to uninstall is MacKeeper. Because what happens is you don't just have the main software, you have all these preference files and stuff like that. What she also had installed on her Mac, which there is no reason for you to have it on, she had virus protection installed on her Mac.
Oh, no.
Now, between me and you, I have virus protection installed on all of my Macs because it is mandated that I have it installed on all of my Macs because I live in a Windows environment on the ship. So work requires me to have virus protection on all my Macs, but us normal people, no need for virus protection on your Mac. So how I uninstalled them is I used a program. It's a free program. This is not something you're going to find in the App Store. You're just going to Google it. It's called App Cleaner.
APPCLEANER.
And all I have to do is anything I want to get rid of, I go into applications. I'm going to show you. I have to find something I want to get rid of.
Get rid of Mac Keeper, huh?
I don't have Mac Keeper on my
phone.
So,
how you get rid of Mac Keeper?
What?
This is how you get rid of Mac Keeper.
And then is it going to keep popping up?
No, once you do this, this gets rid of all your preferences and everything. So this application is not from the App Store, and I know it's more complicated than a single app. So the way he was saying to get rid of it is to take it and drag it to the garbage can.
Yeah, I've done that.
That doesn't do it. That's how Mac Keeper keeps coming back. What you do is you drag your app here. This is in App Cleaner. And you'll see that it has the main applications and preferences applications, a folder, all of these different things.
Oh my gosh.
And this is how you uninstall an app from your Mac. This is the only safe way to uninstall Mac Keeper because Mac Keeper, it's a genius piece of software. And you know what Mac Keeper loves more than anything else? If you have an AOL, Yahoo, or Hotmail account.
I have AOL.
Oh, it loves it. It loves it.
I have to drag each one of those?
Each app you want to get rid of, you drag there, and then you say remove, and it's going to remove the entire application, not just what you can see. It's like Mac Keeper's like an iceberg. You see the little thing that's above the water? But it's a mess underneath the water there. Let me see if I have any other cool apps I want to show you. Actually, I do want to show you another cool app.
They're
it's called.
They're not paying you enough.
They are.
What does Mac Keeper do that you wouldn't want to?
What does Mac Keeper do? Here's the answer to your question. It optimizes, speeds up your Mac, makes your Mac work so much. I'm telling you what they tell you. Makes your Mac work so much better and everything like that. And it installs spyware cookies that track everything you do on the internet and replace your Google ads and all of your web browsers with third-party ads that they monetize and make money off of while redirecting all of your internet traffic. Did that answer your question?
So sucker.
Yeah, sucker. And they changed it. It got such a bad rap that they've changed the names over the years, and they've done just anything that says it's going to clean or speed up your Mac. Don't waste your time.
So you have to install it.
iBoost. I would stay away from iBoost. I have iBoost on my machine, but I'd stay away.
Is it Mac Keeper or Mac?
Mac Keeper. Mac Keeper. Yeah.
It's not automatically in your Mac.
No, you have to install it. Here's what happens. When you go to websites, what you don't realize, you get pop-ups and ads and stuff like that dependent on the browser you're using. So if you're using Safari, almost every pop-up you're going to see is for a program called Mac Keeper. It's a free application, but they can afford all those ads. So you wonder how they can afford all those ads. But what they do is they take over your computer and they sell advertising that replaces the advertising that's actually on your computer. It's a really nasty program. Yeah.
I've noticed with MacKeeper, that usually when you're confronted with do you want to download MacKeeper, it's because you went to this website to download software.
Correct.
Something else.
They advertise on a lot of software things, but I want to show you.
Just went down the wrong
street. I want to show you the last thing. Now, this is a great application that's available for iPhone, for iPad, for Mac. It's available on all the devices except Android and Windows computers. It's called Pixelmator. And what it is cheap, but cheap only in money. It has all the features. Cheap Photoshop.
M-A-T-O-R.
Pixelmator. I'm going to see if I can find a picture to use. This will be interesting.
One word.
Pixelmator. Pixelmator.
Okay.
I'm looking for a picture real quick. Okay. Pixelmator. I don't actually have a picture to do this with. Well, that's an interesting problem to have.
It is.
Well, technically, we can go to Google Photos and we get a picture. Let's go to Google Photos and get a picture. I'll show you how this works real quick. So kind of answer a couple of questions along the way. I'm going to go into iLounge. I'm going to go into Google Photos. It's probably dangerous. Let's go to Google Photos. I'm going to pull a picture down from Google Photos. This is going to show you the whole workflow of how I would go about doing something. So I'm going to pull that. Google keeps changing their terms and conditions and wanting me to agree to the new ones. Photos.google.com. Yes, I agree. Okay. I'm going to log into my Google Photos. I'm going to pull a picture down. I'm going to show you how to do something in Pixelmator that's really cool. What you can do in Pixelmator is you can actually remove things from a picture, add things to pictures. It is Photoshop, but it is so much better than Photoshop because it's easy to use. And it's also across all of your devices. So across Windows, across Mac, across iPhone, across iPad.
That's right. I need something
to do. I'm going to show you how this works. No, it's a couple bucks. It's not that bad. It's not like Photoshop. It doesn't have a monthly subscription fee and all those things like Photoshop. Let me see if I can find a picture real quick that I want to do this with. Okay. Let's go with this one. This is my burger the other day. And if I wanted to take this and download this from Google Photos, something I didn't show, there's these three little buttons in the upper right-hand corner, and then there's a big button that says download. And now I'm actually downloading the actual file. So I have the actual file. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to modify this picture. So watch. I'm going to open it in Pixelmator. I have a lot of programs on my machine. Okay, open it in Pixelmator. Okay, so now we've got that picture inside of Pixelmator. I'm going to try and do some things now.
Could you, like, remove the fire extinguisher?
That's exactly what I was going to do. So I should be able to go in here. I've selected something called a repair tool.
I just tried to do this in Photos yesterday.
No. And the cool thing is Pixelmator links up directly with Photos. So when you hit edit, if you have Pixelmator installed, it'll allow you to actually edit in Pixelmator. I'm not 100% sure how this is going to work. But
we'll see. Then iPhone.
Oh my goodness. That's cool. Then you just need to go in and write
in. Yeah, just do the outline.
Yeah, I can do the outline. I can do the rest. It's got a cloud background, so it's a little difficult. But I can go in and I can delete. If I want to delete those headphones that are around my neck, I could go in and delete them. I'm not sure how that's going to work.
Oh my goodness.
And you can get rid of.
And I'm doing this freehanded. You can also get rid of ex fiancés in pictures. I've used it.
And you can get rid of wrinkles.
Oh my God. Well, he still doesn't have it.
For us. Yeah. Or if I wanted to get rid of that air conditioner back there, I can go in.
That's neat.
But the nicest thing is, this works across Macs, iPhones, and iPads, and it's actually tied into iCloud. So it will synchronize your documents across all of your devices, which is what's very cool. I think I might have something in my iCloud file. Open.
What else can you do?
Oh, you can. It's a full Photoshop software. Let me just see if I have something. Not Playgrounds. Pixelmator. Oh, I have a lot of pictures. I just don't know what they are. Okay.
Santa Claus.
That's my favorite. That is a Jewish Santa Claus. That's me as Santa Claus. I'm the ship Santa. Oh, I shouldn't say it. There's no kids. It's fine. But I can go in and I can delete anything from there. I can, if I wanted to cut myself out and put myself somewhere else, I can do all kinds of different things there. So that's Pixelmator. Pixelmator. And we're going to end on that today. That's available for iPhone, for iPad, for Android. Yeah.
Do sometimes speak about syncing all your devices.
Okay, so let me end this. So that's it. Bye, Mac the Future.